Hello everyone! For today's video, I'm going to read a book and the title of the book is Romance in Atlantis. The Romance of Atlantis by Taylor Caldwell with Jess Stern, first published by William Morrow and Company Incorporated, 1975. An extraordinary manifestation of psychic phenomena, a literal discovery, the first novel by one of America's most popular novelists, written 60 years ago when she was 12, permitted to lie fallow for over half a century and now prepared for publication by a prize-winning reporter, a best-selling author himself and specialist in the occult. Taylor Caldwell's own grandfather, a book editor in Philadelphia, suppressed, for he could not believe that this extraordinary creation was the work of a young girl, could only conclude that it had been plagiarized. Reading the novel today, assured of its authenticity, one nonetheless understands and shares his sense of wonder. In its grasp of technology, for example, it is clearly prophetic for its time, while the detail of scene and action is so ample and varied as to suggest an eyewitness account. And whether or not one finally decides that this is the result of extrasensory perception, or as many will, singular evidence of reincarnation, one is certain to be beguiled. The Atlantis, which Taylor Caldwell pictures for us with such immediacy, is a highly sophisticated society. Its technology is so advanced that it has harnessed both nuclear and solar energy. Its birth control techniques are perfect, though practiced only by the upper classes. It understands the processes of rejuvenation. For all of this, not unlike many other sophisticated cultures, past and present, Atlantis is in moral decay, dissolute, and like an overripe peach ready to fall to the ground. It is a caste society. Faction fights faction and decadence is rife. Moreover, as the novel opens, Atlantis is subject to strange omens and portents. A never-lifting mist hangs over the country and the flow of both nuclear and solar power has been mysteriously interrupted. In the streets of La Mora, the capital city, newly arrived foreigners are proclaiming the one and only true God and prophesying the imminent doom of Atlantis. In the north of the continent, of which Atlantis occupies the temperate southern zones, Signar, king of the Altustrians, is jealous for possession of Atlantis and of its splendid, even glamorous queen, Salustra. It is Salustra, in fact, who provides the focus, and the reader is caught in the ebb and flow of her personal fortunes as well as those of her beloved Atlantis, right up to the cosmic climax. Fascinating in content, dramatic and apt to our times, mysterious in its origins, the Romance of Atlantis is a true wonder. Jess Stern and Taylor Caldwell earlier collaborated on Mr. Stern's The Search for a Soul, Taylor Caldwell's Psychic Lives. From Taylor Caldwell's prose post script to The Romance of Atlantis. I knew months ago that Jess was going to do something about my childhood novel on Atlantis, but I forgot it completely in the stress of my existence, so I have no explanation of suddenly experiencing my life on Atlantis after all these years, when I dreamed that I was the Empress Salustra in this book. This dream happened a few weeks ago, and then in the weeks following, I had two other experiences as the Empress Salustra of Atlantis. I cannot imagine from where these strange dreams emerged or what their significance is, if there is any significance at all. The only thing I know with certainty is that the dreams were more vivid than my present reality. More poignant, more agonizing, and more joyful. They haunt me, coloring my whole existence, and I feel deprived and filled with an ancient longing. Foreword. At the age of 12, Janet Taylor Caldwell wrote a romance of Atlantis, a presumably legendary land that she knew nothing about. Her father, a newspaper artist, was amazed by the perception in the manuscript, its detail and insight. He sent it to the child's grandfather, a book editor in Philadelphia. The latter, promptly horrified, suggested the manuscript be destroyed immediately. He did not feel that any child could have produced so unusually mature a work, intellectually and philosophically. The only alternative that suggested itself was that she had borrowed freely elsewhere. In a way, he was right. She had borrowed from the past, not knowing herself how she was dredging up that past. The manuscript lay fallow for 60 years, then on the strength of my collaboration with the novelist in The Search for a Soul, The Psychic Lives of Taylor Caldwell, I was given the task of readying the manuscript for publication. Provocative situations that Miss Caldwell had touched upon were amplified, some of the child's prose simplified, but the situation's descriptions, characters, and storyline remained pretty much as they inexplicably came from the pen of a 12-year-old child. The insight, the wisdom, the biting wit, the disenchantment, and yet the eternal optimism that intrigued and affected me are still there, together with an allegorical narrative that seems to fit our world with dramatic aptness. Indeed, it almost seems at times that the famous novelist